That's entertainment. How talent and technology created a world. Part 3, phonographs and radios.
Table of contents, phonographs and radios.
That's entertainment. The empire built by talent and technology. In the olden days before the modern era.
Dr. Sidney Sokoloff. DrSidney22@gmail.com. 2023. Narration by Dr. Sidney Sokoloff.
Zoe Phonemes.
And Nathan Cole Tove. For a complete discussion of YouTube navigation, please go to tiny.one/ytnavigator. That's entertainment. The empire built by talent and technology. The beginnings, phonographs and radios. Most of our entertainment in the present day comes to us through wireless communications, such as radios, cell phones, and television. Now we will have a little science lesson, a very short, maybe a 15 or 20 minute digression into the science behind wireless communication.
We will next have a short video clip of what is the electromagnetic spectrum.
Hi, I'm Emerald Robinson. In this What Is video, we're going to take a closer look at the electromagnetic spectrum. What we see as light is only a small part of the electromagnetic spectrum. The electromagnetic spectrum refers to the many types of radiation released from stars, including our own sun. Electromagnetic radiation travels in waves. Frequency describes how many waves per second a wavelength produces. Wavelength measures the length of an individual wave in meters. Scientists describe the electromagnetic spectrum as a long line. At one end lie radio waves, with the longest wavelengths and lowest frequencies in the spectrum. A single radio wave has the length of a football field. After radio waves come microwaves, which produce more energy due to shorter wavelengths and higher frequencies. Cell phones, radar, and microwave ovens use microwaves. Next comes infrared light. The sun, fire, living creatures, and other heat sources all produce infrared light. While we cannot see infrared light, we feel it as heat. Visible light occupies a narrow slice of the electromagnetic spectrum, nestled between infrared and ultraviolet light. Red wavelengths have the lowest frequencies and longest wavelengths of visible light. As you move from red through orange, yellow, green, blue, and finally violet, wavelengths shorten and frequencies increase. From visible violet light, we move into ultraviolet frequencies. Human skin produces vitamin D when exposed to ultraviolet light, but excessive ultraviolet light causes sunburns. Next, X-rays, which pass through soft tissue but not denser materials such as bone, making them valuable for medical tests. X-rays also have security applications such as airport baggage checks. Gamma rays produce even shorter wavelengths, higher frequencies, and more energy. In comparison to the football field-sized wavelengths of radio waves, gamma ray wavelengths are as small as atom nuclei.
For thousands of how-to and advice videos on any topic, visit monkeysee.com.
Radio waves, infrared rays, visible light, ultraviolet rays, X-rays, and gamma rays are all types of electromagnetic radiation. Radio waves have the longest wavelength, and gamma rays have the shortest wavelength.
This again shows the types of electromagnetic radiation from radio waves to microwaves. Infrared, visible light, ultraviolet, X-rays, and gamma rays.
The wavelength is inversely proportional to the frequency, as the wavelength equals the speed of light divided by the frequency.
All objects emit electromagnetic radiation. The hotter the object, the more radiation is emitted, and the shorter the wavelength. Warm things emit a tiny amount of radiation, mainly in the infrared region.
As an object gets hotter, it begins to glow, emitting more in the visible region. First a dull red, and then shifting to blue and white hot as the temperature increases.
This shows how the color of an object corresponds to its temperature. Initially, hot objects glow red, then yellow-orange, and finally white. That is, white hot as the temperature increases.
The wavelength, lambda, of an electromagnetic wave is related to the frequency f, by lambda equals c over f, where c is the velocity of light, 3 times 10 to the 8th power, meters per second.
This shows the region of the electromagnetic spectrum, from the infrared to the visible, and then to the ultraviolet region.
The basic building block of radio communication is a radio wave. Like waves on a pond, a radio wave is a series of repeating peaks and valleys.
The entire pattern of a wave, before it repeats itself, is called a cycle. The number of cycles, or times a wave repeats in a second, is called the frequency. The wavelength is the distance a wave takes to complete one cycle.
Frequency is measured in units of hertz, referring to the number of cycles per second. 1000 hertz is referred to as a kilohertz, 1 million hertz as megahertz, and 1 billion hertz as gigahertz. The range of the radio spectrum is from 3 kilohertz up to 300 gigahertz.
A radio wave is generated by a transmitter and then detected by a receiver. An antenna allows a radio transmitter to send energy into space and a receiver to pick up energy from space. Transmitters and receivers are typically designed to operate over a limited range of frequencies.
The two basic ways that information is carried by radio waves are amplitude modulation, or AM, and frequency modulation, or FM.
These are the basic elements of a radio communication system.
Digital signal communication. This shows how analog and digital signals change with time. The strength or amplitude of an analog signal is proportional to, or an analog of, some physical property, such as the amplitude of a sound wave or the brightness of some point of light.
Digital signals are usually binary signals having just two values or states, referred to as 0 and 1. Or off and on, they do not resemble the original signal in any way, but are digitally encoded. For example, in the binary, or base-to encoding system, we have these binary digit sequences corresponding to our usual base 10 numbers.
To produce a digital signal, the analog voltage representing some physical quantity is quantized by sampling the voltage at successive intervals to obtain the corresponding binary digital values.
This is an example of a binary digital signal in which the zero state is represented as 0 volts, and the one state is 5 volts. Digital signals require much more bandwidth or frequency space than analog signals, but are much less susceptible to interference or noise.
As long as the noise or interference level is not too high, a noise-free replica of a digital signal can be made. That is one of the big advantages of digital over analog.
Another advantage of digital over analog is in signal processing. Once a signal is in digital form, it can be transformed or compressed in many different ways.
One of the earliest mass entertainment devices was the phonograph, or gramophone, invented by Thomas Edison in 1877. We will now have a short video clip of how is music stored on vinyl records.
Music means a lot to us. By just putting a record on, it helps us process emotions, escape reality, or just get really pumped up about something. But how did that music get on a piece of vinyl in the first place, and how does it make music to our ears? Hey audiophiles, Julia here for D News. I know it seems like a simple thing, but how do we record sounds onto vinyl?
How does this vibration produced in our throats get carried through the air and captured on a disc? Well, it wasn't easy. For centuries, there were attempts to transcribe sound onto paper. Back in the mid-19th century, scientists were studying how sound waves move through the air and vibrate. Inspired by studies of the inner ear, French scientist Edouard Leon Scott de Martinville tried to recreate the eardrum with a thin membrane. Attaching this membrane to a stylus or etching pen, he could trace the vibrations that hit that membrane onto a piece of paper or glass. But it took at least 20 years for anyone to realize that, hey, these 2D lines on a piece of paper, if turned into 3D grooves in something, might be able to be played back. The earliest attempts at recording the human voice go back to the 1870s, and like most inventions of that era, was developed at Thomas Edison's labs. Once we had sound waves figured out, there had to be a way to mark them down somehow and replay them later. Edison's labs came up with a cylinder covered in tin foil with a needle attached to a thin membrane called a diaphragm. As sound waves hit the diaphragm, they jiggled the needle, which etched the vibrations and movements into the cylinder. But he wasn't the only one working on it. Emil Berliner developed a similar system, but his had a hand crank that turned not a cylinder, but a flat disc, cutting three-dimensional grooves of sound waves directly into it. The needle or stylus would read the grooves, producing a sound that was amplified by a horn or a cone, and thus the gramophone was invented in 1887. And that's still kind of how analog sound is played today. Records work on a similar principle, only instead of recording it fresh each time, it's recorded to a master disc and then pressed into vinyl. Today's record players have the stylus, usually made from diamond or sapphire, attached to a tone arm. That's the thing you pick up and move to put on a record. Tone arms can be straight or curved, and there's some debate as to which is better. And the sound isn't amplified mechanically. Instead, it's carried through the tone arm to a cartridge containing coils and a magnetic field. These coils take the vibrations and amplify them electronically through speakers. But on a warmer note, many record fans say they sound just that. They believe records sound better and warmer than other forms of recording because of its fidelity. But that's an arguable case. But maybe the rise of record players lately is simply because many vinyl files say they have an emotional connection to records. Some say it's a nostalgia factor. Others like that records are so tangible, they're something that you can really see and feel. Maybe it's the appeal of the ritual, the taking off the jacket, placing the record on the table, and finally getting the stylus literally in the groove. So while some might get a little down on digital recording, it can be awesome. I mean, modern scientists have even found a way to listen to those Scott de Martinville recordings using a virtual stylus. Seriously, it's really creepy. Give it a listen. There's a link down in the description below. All right, audiophiles, it's your turn. Do you still listen to old vinyl records? Do you think it's better than digital? Debate down in the comments below. Don't forget to hit those like and subscribe buttons and keep coming back to D News. We've got new episodes every day of the week.
We will next have a short video clip of the invention of the phonograph.
A telephone transmitter that led Edison to his most startling invention. He suspected that a vibrating needle point would leave indentations on a piece of paper, indentations that could then be played back.
They tried it, and it worked enough immediately, that is, they got some buzzing noise out of the paper when they pulled it back underneath, that they realized that this was a possibility. Then they sat down, and in thinking about it and its possibilities, realized they had just recorded sound.
Edison switched from paper to tin foil and actually recorded the human voice.
So by turning the tin foil flywheel and getting a constant speed, you can shout into this machine. Testing 1, 2, 3, 4! Mary had a little lamb, its fleece as white as snow.
The device is a marvel of simplicity. The human voice vibrates a diaphragm, moving a stylus, which leaves grooves on the tin foil. When the machine is returned to the starting point, the grooves cause the diaphragm to vibrate again, reproducing the original sound. In the late 19th century, no one even considered that sound could be reproduced by a machine.
All of a sudden, here was something brand new. You could record an event and then listen to it again. The phonograph made him the Wizard of Menlo Park. It made him world famous instantly. In the end of 1877, the beginning of 1878, when people realized he wasn't lying, that he could really do this.
Francis Yale worked with Edison as a lab assistant. 50 years after that, he recalled the reaction to Edison's amazing phonograph.
People flocked here in multitudes to hear a machine talk. A simple machine. They could not believe it. I well remember the day when The phonograph was presented before the French Academy of Science, and two of its most illustrious members got up and said, "It is impossible. The man that's turning the crank is a ventriloquist. It's an American hoax."
In Edison's original phonograph of 1877, words spoken loudly into the recording sound box were converted by a vibrating diaphragm and a needle-like recording stylus into a series of tiny pits impressed in the tinfoil covering of a cardboard cylinder.
The cylinder was turned by a hand crank for both recording and playing. During playback, a light stylus traced over the series of pits, vibrating a ripper to set diaphragm and H creating the original spoken words.
This is Edison's first phonograph of 1877. This is Thomas Edison with his second phonograph, photographed by Levin Corbin Handy in Washington in April 1878.
This is the Edison wax cylinder phonograph, circa 1899.
We will next have a video clip of how the cylinder phonograph works.
I'm Bob Loquist, and I'd like to introduce you to Thomas Edison's cylinder phonograph.
Whistling sold all over the waves world by Joe Belmont, Edison Records.
Let's take a look at how the phonograph actually works. Probably the most intricate part is the reproducer, which contains the diaphragm. I'll get a clear shot of this. But basically the diaphragm is hidden within the metal and connected to the needle by means of a very, very thin wire. The needle itself is sapphire, unlike most of the other competitors of the period, which used abradable steel needles. The weight on the record is provided by this lever here. So again, the needle is totally suspended by a little wire on a lever motion with a weight provided by this. The volume really comes from this mass bearing on the cylinder. Now the reproducer is put into the carriage. Now, unlike the Victor system, which used disc records, the carriage is propelled along the cylinder by a feed gear. Again, you have a half nut that goes into a gear. When this is engaged, this moves it along. The cylinder spins at 160 RPM. The length of the records for these early machines is exactly 2 minutes. This mechanism would be familiar to any machinist of the era, as what you would have in a lathe for cutting screw threads. Let's take a look inside. As you've seen me before, this is a hand-cranked spring-driven phonograph. Believe it or not, it took them almost 20 years to come up with a spring-driven motor. They had all sorts of weird other things, like they used electric motors, they used like water-driven motors, they used like foot treadles, like in a sewing machine, but it took them a while to actually perfect a spring gear. But let's pop this thing open and see what it looks like. Take the handle out. Open this up. I chose this particular model to show you because you can see most of the parts, but let's set it going and see what it does. Again, you can see the movement of the half nut along the feed gear, and that's what propels the carriage along with the stylus along the record. It isn't the needle riding in the grooves that moves the record the way it does in more modern recordings. Inside, you can see the guts of the motor. This thing rotating around is the spring contained within a cast metal jacket, because these springs are very, very powerful, and occasionally they broke, and it could break almost explosively with the amount of energy that's in here. This is the governor spinning around here, and again, its construction would be familiar to anybody in the 19th century as a governor, same sort of governor they use on a steam engine. Regulates the speed quite accurately, really. The rest of this stuff is pretty much, almost very much like clockwork to transmit the energy from the motor over finally to the shaft. But here you can see it's actually pulley driven. This is a leather pulley. going up through the mechanism here. Again, these were all designed to only play at one speed to play a 2-minute record. Some of the later models actually had several speeds. They could play like 2- and 4-minute records, in which case you had to pull a knob to change the gear speed. One other thing I'd like to mention is about the horns. The horns were actually sold as a separate accessory. You had to pay extra for these things. They gave you pretty much a minimal horn, but if you wanted a louder horn, you had to pay through the nose for it. This was pretty much the standard picnic horn, which you would take outside when you're on a picnic. But if you wanted to fill your home with sound, you would pay, well, maybe $10 extra for a louder horn. That would go on a horn crane to support this thing. And they have even larger ones. And a whole cottage industry existed for making horns for these things by the individual dealers. They would make you paper mache, wood horns, flower horns, anything you wanted.
We will next hear a rare Edison advertisement on a cylinder from 1906.
I am the Edison phonograph, created by the great wizard of the new world to delight those who would have melody or be amused. I can sing you tender songs of love. I can give you merry tales and joyous laughter. I can transport you to the realms of music. I can cause you to join in the rhythmic dance. I can lull the babe to sweet repose, or waken in the aged heart soft memories of youthful days. No matter what may be your mood, I am always ready to entertain you. When your day's work is done, I can bring the theater or the opera to your home. I can give you grand opera, comic opera, or vaudeville. I can give you sacred or popular music, band, orchestra, or instrumental music. I can render solos, duets, trios, quartets. I can aid in entertaining your guests. When your wife is worried after the cares of the day and the children are boisterous, I can rest the one and quiet the other. I never get tired, and you will never tire of me, for I always have something new to offer. I give pleasure to all, young and old. I will go wherever you want me, in the parlor, in the sick room, on the porch, in the camp, or to your summer home. If you sing or talk to me, I will retain your songs or words and repeat them to you at your pleasure. I can enable you to always hear the voices of your loved ones, even though they are far away. I talk in every language. I can help you to learn other languages. I am made with the highest degree of mechanical skill. My voice is the clearest, smoothest, and most natural of any talking machine. The name of my famous master is on my body and tells you that I am a genuine Edison phonograph. The more you become acquainted with me, the better you will like me. Ask the dealer.
We will next have a video clip of the Edison phonograph and audio recording history.
Today we're used to having recorded music wherever and whenever we want it. We can listen to audio on hi-fi systems, audio that's streamed over the internet to mobile phones or other devices, and we can have music downloads on other audio players. We can even have high-quality digital radio as well. And of course, CDs are still very widely used as they provide very faithful reproduction of the sound. CDs were revolutionary when they were introduced, offering very high-quality audio in a relatively small size. Before that, there were the audio cassettes, which offered convenience and they were contained in a compact package. You could record your own cassettes or buy pre-recorded music. Earlier still, there were the 33 RPM vinyl long-playing records and 45s for singles. These were preceded by the lovely old 78s using wind-up record players. They had a certain sound and atmosphere to them. You start to appreciate how far we've actually come when you come across a really old player. It could even be like this Edison phonograph that could have been found in an attic or somewhere else. Edison invented the phonograph in 1877, filing his patent on the 24th of December of that year, but it took him until the 1880s to launch the first machines. These early phonographs used a cylinder instead of a disc, and they initially lasted for only 2 minutes. So let's hear what one of these Edison phonographs sounds like. The head or reproducer was moved laterally along the recording by a screw thread on the back of the machine. This meant the machine and the recording had to track at the same rate. Later machines, though, had an option for 2 or 4 minute plays, the long playing versions being accommodated by reducing the drive speed to the tracking thread by half in the gearing system. These record players were powered by clockwork. There was a large wind-up spring, and to regulate the speed, a governor similar to that used on railway steam engines was used. The sound was not great by today's standards, but seeing them and hearing them now generates a certain magic, even if, like this one, they're not in tip-top condition.
Edison's phonograph used a waxed cylinder. A major improvement was the use of a flat disc record, introduced by Emil Berliner in 1887. The flat disc had the major advantage of being reproduced by stamping.
The early phonographs were entirely acoustical. Starting in the 1920s, microphones were used for recording, and loudspeakers for playback, together with electric amplification using the newly developed triode vacuum tube. By 1925, electrical recording allowed all the major labels to start using microphones in studio sessions.
The clear tone compared to acoustic recordings meant that acoustic recordings could no longer compete with their electrically recorded counterparts. So all the major labels moved over to electrical recordings.
The phonograph allowed singers to have their voices heard everywhere, and not just limited to theaters and opera houses. In 1904, Enrico Caruso became the first superstar recording artist. First recorded by the Gramophone Company, Caruso made over £1 million in royalties as a result of his contacts with the Gramophone Company.
We will next hear a short clip of "O Susanna" by the Criterion Quartet on an Edison Diamond Disc record, 1924.
Alabama, we've a banjo on the knee. Oh,
Next, have a short video clip of Enrico Caruso singing Santru Lucia in 1934.
Lucido, Lucido, prospero.
modern devices, tape, CD, and MP3 players. With the development of transistors and miniaturized electronic devices starting in the 1950s, the old-fashioned phonograph has largely been rendered obsolete.
Listening to music and audiobooks can be very useful for seniors, especially for those with vision problems.
An important activity for good health is walking. Listening to music or an audiobook while walking adds to the enjoyment of it and can encourage more and lengthier walks.
Audiobooks are available in two basic formats: compact disc or CD, and MP3.
CDs can be purchased or obtained from a library. This is an inexpensive portable CD player with headphones and an LCD screen.
One of the most convenient ways to do this is an MP3 player. There are a tremendous variety of audiobooks and music that can be downloaded from the internet to an MP3 player.
Most convenient for portability is an MP3 player, eh?
This is an Apple iPod Touch MP3 player.
There are many sources for audiobooks on the internet. One extensive source is Audible.com. One good source for audiobooks that can be downloaded is Audible.com.
It is easy to search for books. This is the result of my search.
Upon selecting the search results, we got this description.
It is useful to know what other people think of the book. This is an example of the result of a search on Audible.
Information about the contents and the ability to hear a 5-minute sample is available.
Radio. From the 1920s to the appearance of television in the 1950s, radio was the dominant form of entertainment in the home.
This was especially true in the evening hours when families would gather around the radio to listen to their favorite radio shows.
Radio waves were first identified and studied by German physicist Heinrich Hertz in 1886.
The first practical radio transmitters and receivers were developed around 1895 to 1896 by Italian Guglielmo Marconi. And radio began to be used commercially around 1900. The first commercial public radio station in the U.S. is KDKA in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, which went on the air November 2, 1920, with the presidential election results as its inaugural show, but did not broadcast daily until 1921. We will next have a short video clip of how radio broadcast works.
Radio broadcasting works by translating sounds into electromagnetic waves called radio waves. A radio station sends the radio waves through the air. A radio picks up the waves and changes them into sound. In a radio station, a microphone picks up speech, music, and other sounds of a radio program.
Hello!
The microphone creates an electric current or signal that corresponds to the pattern of the sound waves. The signal is sent to a transmitter. There it's combined with another electric current called a carrier signal. The combined signal is sent to an antenna, which broadcasts it as radio waves of an assigned frequency. The radio waves carry the sound information as either FM signals or AM signals. FM signals can reach ground-based receivers only as far as the horizon. AM signals can reach receivers beyond the horizon because they bounce off a layer of the atmosphere. But AM signals are more susceptible to static than FM signals. A radio antenna picks up all broadcast signals that reach it. The listener adjusts the radio's tuner to make the receiver sensitive to the frequency of a particular station. When radio waves reach a radio's antenna, they produce an electric current within it. This current contains the sound information that was carried in the radio waves. Inside the radio, the receiver sends the sound signal to the speakers.
Hello!
For more information about radio broadcasting, click the See Article button to see the section How Radio Works in the radio article.
We will next have a short video clip of how does radio work 3D animation.
Sound is first converted into electric signals with a microphone. After modulation and amplification, signals are sent through the air as electromagnetic radio waves using antennas. During modulation, input signals are combined with electrically induced radio waves, as transmission is only effective if the frequency of the carrier wave is much higher than that of the input signal. When the amplitude of the carrier wave is changed in accordance with the intensity of the signal, the process is called amplitude modulation, or AM. When the frequency of the signal is changed according to the intensity of the signal, the process is called frequency modulation, or FM. AM signals are used for long-distance broadcasting. These waves can travel thousands of kilometers as the upper layer of the atmosphere and the ground reflect them multiple times. AM signals are subject to static and interference, however. That's why AM broadcasting tends to be noisier. The main parts of the radio are the tuner, located in the integrated circuit, the demodulator, the amplifier, and the speaker. The tuner is used to search for the frequency of the station we wish to listen to. The demodulator, also called the detector, demodulates the radio signal selected by the tuner by separating it from the carrier wave. The wave is then amplified in the amplifier and transmitted to the speaker. Here, electric signals cause the membrane in the speaker to vibrate and create sound waves.
We will next have a short video clip of a brief history of radio.
Radio. You know, that old dusty thing that sits up at the front of your car or in the corner of your house. Most of us are too occupied with television, our iPods, or video games to really listen to it. But the impact it has had on our world is immense. It all started in 1873 when James Clerk Maxwell showed mathematically that electromagnetic waves could travel through air. Before long, in 1888, Heinrich Hertz demonstrated Maxwell's theory by demonstrating that someone could produce and detect electromagnetic radiation. Then, in 1892, Nikola Tesla used Maxwell's mathematic findings to demonstrate the sending and receiving of radio frequency energy. He proposed that this method could be used for sending and receiving information. But it was Guglielmo Marconi who built the first wireless transmitter in 1896, which was capable of sending signals up to 1.5 miles. He then proceeded to develop the world's first transatlantic radio communication service between Clifton, Ireland, and Newfoundland in 1901. The next evolution in radio technology was the invention of the spark gap transmitter. This device allowed for the production of the first commercially available radio sets. But the spark gap radios were plagued with problems, mainly electrical interference. These were greatly improved with the invention and production of crystal radio sets. The crystal sets were the first widely produced and widely used radio sets in America. These crystal sets were widely used in most American homes by the 1920s. It was the American family's connection to the rest of the country. This was fantastic, but there was still a problem that needed to be fixed. Up to this time, all radio was being broadcast using AM waves. AM stands for amplitude modulation. But the problem was that AM radio is medium range and is prone to be blocked by urban structures. But in 1933, Edwin H. Armstrong invented FM radio. FM stands for frequency modulation. This type of broadcasting method uses a wavelength that is less prone to static and blockage. It also has a longer range. With the invention of FM, radio only needed one more evolution to become what you know today. That last advancement was the transistor radio. The transistor radio had particular advantages over the old crystal sets. The transistor sets were much cheaper than the crystal ones, used less power, had a smaller size, and had a very long lifespan.
We will next have a short video clip of how radio works.
Radio waves are part of the electromagnetic spectrum, which also includes X-rays and visible light. Generation of radio waves uses the relationship between electricity and magnetism. If an electric battery and a magnetic compass are joined in a circuit, whenever you complete the circuit, the compass needle moves. The magnetic field that has been created can also be detected in another circuit placed near to the first. This is how radio waves travel across space. With powerful transmitters, they are sent very long distances and picked up by an aerial on the receiver. To send complex signals, a sine wave can be used, which is continuously changed through modulation. The height or amplitude of the wave can be varied, or its frequency, the number of wave crests per second, which is counted in hertz. The varying pattern carries the message. The wavelength is the distance between wave crests, and is typically hundreds of meters for radio waves. But the frequency is millions of waves per second, because radio travels at the speed of light. There are very many radio waves all around us, so a receiver must have a tuner in order to isolate a particular signal, as well as an amplifier to make it stronger. Modern digital radio breaks the signal into pieces coded as numbers, which are reassembled into sound at the receiver. They are transmitted across much wider frequency bands than analog radio. This gives a more reliable signal, and it means that one digital signal can carry many programs at the same time. Radio frequency bands are allocated for different purposes. Television, for example, uses higher frequencies than radio broadcasting. ITU is where international agreements are made about allocating frequencies for the many services that use radio today, including mobile phones and other devices.
Technical advances, amplification.
The Audion was an electronic detecting or amplifying vacuum tube invented by American electrical engineer Lee D. Forrest in 1906.
The Audion was the first triode, consisting of an evacuated glass tube containing three electrodes, a heated filament, a grid, and a plate.
The Audion is important in the history of technology because it was the first widely used electronic device that could amplify. A small electrical signal applied to the grid could control a larger current flowing from the filament to the plate.
John Bardeen, William Shockley, and Walter Brattain at Bell Labs invented the point contact transistor in 1947, and the bipolar junction transistor in 1948.
This is a replica of the first working transistor. A point contact transistor invented in 1947.
We will next have a short video clip of the first commercial radio broadcast on KDKA Pittsburgh, November 2, 1920.
This is KDKA of the Westinghouse Electric and Manufacturing Company in East Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. We shall now broadcast the election returns. We are receiving these returns through the cooperation and by special arrangements with the Pittsburgh Post and Sun. We'd appreciate it if anyone hearing this broadcast would communicate with us, as we are very anxious to know how far the broadcast is reaching and how it is being received. While we're waiting for the returns to come in over the telephone, direct from the Post and Sun, I'll give you the list of offices in today's presidential election. Here they are. Some 30 million Americans are electing a president of the United States, a vice president, 34 United States senators, 435 members of the House of Representatives, governors of 34 states, and thousands of minor offices, county judges, and officials. Okay, those are the offices to be filled. And here are the seven complete presidential tickets that are being voted on. Republican, Warren G. Harding, and Calvin Coolidge. Democratic, James M. Cox.
The Grand Ole Opry is the longest-running radio show in the United States.
On November 28, 1925, the Grand Ole Opry was born when a radio announcer, George D. Hay, went live on the IFO his first broadcast of a program that was, at the time, called the WSM Barn Dance.
We will next have a short video clip of the first Grand Ole Opry broadcast, November 28, 1925.
Hello and welcome to History Pod. On the 28th of November 1925, American country music radio show The Grand Ole Opry was broadcast for the first time. The Grand Ole Opry is the longest running radio show in US history and began as a weekly stage concert broadcast known as the WSM Barn Dance. The show was the brainchild of George D. Hay, an experienced radio personality who was hired to be station manager at the newly established WSM AM in Nashville, Tennessee. The station was owned by the National Life and Accident Insurance Company and broadcast from the company's office in downtown Nashville. Hay had previously been the announcer for the National Barn Dance program at WLS in Chicago, and created a version of the station's successful old-time music program when he took up his new position in Nashville. On the 28th of November 1925, the show was launched with a performance by Uncle Jimmy Thompson, a 77-year-old fiddler who'd been recommended by his niece, who happened to work at the station as a piano accompanist. Thompson's performance began at 8 p.m. and saw him take requests from the public, who flooded the station with phone calls and telegrams. His appearance was an immediate hit, but as the program adopted a more formal structure, Thompson's involvement began to decline. Hay began to feature a roster of string bands and singers, and after the broadcast was given a regular Saturday night slot, it was renamed the Grand Ole Opry in May 1926. As the radio show developed a variety format, live audiences were invited to come and watch the show. Due to demand, the Grand Ole Opry was soon forced to broadcast from a procession of larger venues beyond the studio and move to its current home at the 4,000-seater Grand Ole Opry House in 1974.
Bing Crosby was a very popular singing star in the early days of radio.
We will next have a short video clip of the song "Where the Blue of the Night Meets the Gold of the Day," sung by Bing Crosby from the 1932 Hits Archive.
Why must I live in dreams of the days I used to know? Why can't I find real peace of mind and return to the long ago, where the blue of the night meets the gold of the day? Someone waits for me, and the gold of her hair crowns the blue of her eyes like a halo tenderly. If only I could see her, oh, how happy I would be, where the blue of the night meets the gold of the day. Someone waits for me. If only I could see her, oh, how happy I would be, where the blue of the night meets the gold of the day. Someone waits for me.
Frank Sinatra was a very popular singing star in the golden age of radio. The 1930s and 40s.
We will next have a video clip of Frank Sinatra singing New York, New York.
Greatest city in the whole world. Start spreading the news. I'm leaving today. I want to be a part of it. New York, New York. These vagabond shoes, they are longing to stray right through the very heart of it. New York, New York. I want to wake up, Mary, in a city that doesn't sleep, and find I'm king of the hill, top of the heap. My little town blue, they are melting away. I'll make a brand new start of it in old New York. If I can make it there, I'll make it anywhere. It's up to you, New York.
This is a photograph from the Jack Benny radio show of Eddie Anderson, Dennis Day, Phil Harris, Mary Livingston, Jack Benny, Don Wilson, and Mel Blanc.
We will next have a short video of a 1942 segment of the Jack Benny radio show.
I met a boy right after lunch. He got me away from the rest of the bunch. He kissed me, then ran like a deer. If he comes back, I'll buy him a beer.
That's about the silliest anything you've done this year.
When he grabbed me, I near froze, but his aim was bad, and he kissed my nose.
He kissed your nose?
Yes. However, boys, I'm not complaining. He'd only had his basic training. We're glad to be here, old Camp Hon. Phil and Dennis, me and Don.
What about me?
And good old Jack, who is our clown man.
And Virgil Reimer, world's best sound man.
Virgil, you keep out of this. Jerk.
The end.
We will next have a short video clip of the Lucky Strike ad from the Jack Benny radio show, featuring the Sportsman Quartet.
I don't have enough trouble. Phil has to call up. I wish the doctor would get here. I feel awful. Oh, there it goes again. I can't move. Answer that, will you, Mary?
Oh, all right, all right. Don't be so grouchy.
Don't be so grouchy. Don't be so grouchy.
Hello?
Hello, Mary. This is Don. How's Jack feeling?
Oh, he acts like he's the only one in the world who has a cold. Like a big baby.
Well, maybe he's a lot worse than you think. Gesundheit, Mary.
That was Jack.
Oh, well, let me speak to him.
Here, Jack.
Hello, Don. What do you want?
Gesundheit, and I'll put Mary back on.
Never mind, Mary. What do you want?
Well, the Sportsman Quartet is over here at my house.
Well, why aren't they over here? I want to hear the song they're going to do on our program Sunday.
Oh, they can't take a chance coming to your house, Jack. After all, they're singers. They might catch your cold.
Cold or no cold, they're supposed to come over here and rehearse the number. A lot they think of my program.
Now, wait a minute, Jack. You're taking the wrong attitude.
What?
As soon as the boys heard about your cold, they were very concerned, and they've got some good advice for you.
Advice?
Yeah, here. I'll put them on the phone.
Look, boys, when I've got a cold, I don't need any advice.
Give it to him, boys!
Look, Don, I don't need any advice.
Button up your overcoat when the wind is free. Take good care of yourself. Careful, Mr. B.
Careful.
Eat an apple every day. Go to bed by 3. Take good care of yourself. Passing NBC. Be careful in the breeze. Ooh. Watch it, please, ooh, or you'll sneeze, ooh. You'll get a cold and ruin your program.
Look, I've got a cold. Really I don't have to get one now.
Call a doctor, do. Take good care of yourself, cause we all love you. When you're buying cigarettes, buy the brand you like. Take good care of yourself, smoke a Lucky Strike. When you're driving in a car, or you're on a hike. Take good care of yourself, smoke a Lucky Strike.
If I may have my say,
please do.
Don't delay.
What's new?
Start today.
Ooh, light up a Lucky and you'll enjoy it. Men will know tobacco best. Smoke the best you see. Round, firm, fully packed, LSMFT. LSMFT.
The Fibber McGee and Molly radio show was an important part of the golden age of radio, and had a very long and successful run from 1935 to 1959.
We will next have a short video clip of the Hall Closet episode from the Fibber McGee and Molly radio show. 26 seconds.
Are you ready?
Hurry up, Molly. This is the most important meeting since I've been chamber of the president of president of the Chamber of Commerce. Where's my speech?
It's in your portfolio.
Yeah, I know, but where's my portfolio? Oh, I know. It's right here in the hall closet.
Straighten out this closet one of these days.
Rudy Valli was a famous singer on the radio in the 1930s and 1940s.
We will next have a video clip of Rudy Valli singing The One in the World in 1929.
seems that fate arranged our meeting when you came my way. And though my actions seemed unruly, I loved you truly. To all the world I am repeating, I just got to say, I knew you were the one in the world, the only one who knew that love and I were running the world for you. No one but you. You brought the moon, the sun in the world. You took away the rain. You made me feel what's real in the world. Built my castles in Spain. My heart won't behave it till you are mine. For I'm your willing slave, I worship at your shrine. Why care what else is done in the world? Whatever is to be, I know you are the one in the world for me.
The Edgar Bergen and Charlie McCarthy Show was on the radio for a very long run. From 1937 to 1956. We will next have a short video clip of the It Must Be Good comedy skit with Edgar Bergen and his papa Charlie McCarthy.
This is the cast of the Pepsodent Show. Bob Hope's radio show. In the 1946 to 1947 season. Shown here are from left to right, Desi Arnaz is the band leader. Vera Vague. Jerry Kalana. Bob Hope. And Wendell Niles the announcer.
We will next have a short video clip from the Bob Hope radio show. Episode 13 of the 1938 to 1939 season.
Thanks for the memory. And as we bid adieu, the sponsor, cast and crew, and I all join in wishing best of Christmas time to you. And thank you so much. Thanks for the memory of Singleton and Lake, your Dagwood Blondie team, was just as grand to work with as to see upon the screen. And thank you so much. Here's a tip to all you Christmas shoppers. Buy a gift for yourself while it's early. Treat your friends to a smile bright and pearly. Bright smiles are sent by Pepsodent.
Excuse me, Bob, but who's going to be with us next week?
Well, Bill, next week we're going to have with us that great radio team, Lum and Abner. We're really going down to Pine Ridge with them. Then we'll have Skinny Ennis and his band, our six hits and a miss, Jerry Colonna, and
Bob Hope.
Thank you, Bill Goodwin. Good night, ladies and gentlemen, and may I wish you a Merry Christmas on behalf of the sponsor, Cass and Pete.
Until next Tuesday night at the same time, the Pepsodent Company bids you good night. Bill Goodwin speaking. This is the National Broadcasting Company.
Amplitude modulation and frequency modulation.
You have probably heard the terms AM, or amplitude modulation, and FM, frequency modulation. Maybe in connection to radio stations. Quite possibly AM and FM don't mean anything to you. But let us find out what these terms mean.
In most simple terms, both systems modulate a high-frequency carrier by the signal information in AM. The amplitude of the carrier is modulated or changed in proportion to the signal. But in FM, the frequency is modulated or varied by the signal.
We will next have a short video clip about the difference between AM and FM radio.
Maybe it's just because I'm old, but even though Spotify, podcasts, and other forms of audio streaming seem to rule the day, there's just something comforting about the simplicity of turning a knob on the radio and listening to what's happening on the airwaves. Even in the digital age, radio has maintained a fair amount of popularity since the first public broadcasts in the early 20th century. But since radio has been around since long before we had things like digital decoders that turn electrical impulses into music, how the heck do simple, cheap radios know how to convert an electromagnetic radio signal into a, let's say a basketball game or a weather report or a, you know, Justin Bieber's greatest, who put that crap in my script? Anyway. AM radio broadcasts showed up before FM, so we'll start with those. An AM station will broadcast a signal at a constant frequency, but will add the sound wave representing the actual audio to that base signal. It's also called a carrier wave, resulting in the height or amplitude of the wave changing accordingly. This is where the term AM comes from, as it stands for amplitude modulation. You can get your radio to play back this signal as actual music or dialogue by tuning it to whatever frequency the station that you're looking for broadcasts at. This makes your antenna resonate at the frequency and ignore everything else in the air. So very simple radio tuners are actually little more than coils of wire. How many turns of the wire will determine what frequency you're picking up. Cool, right? The antenna actually creates an electrical current that corresponds to the radio signal. This current is sent to other parts of your radio that filter out the irrelevant parts of the signal and send it to your speakers or your headphones as changes in voltage, which drive those speakers and produce sound. It's actually pretty remarkable that this is all done without any digital decoding by something like a CPU. It's a completely analog process that made it possible for news, music, and entertainment to stream into homes decades before the internet or even TV. FM broadcasting works somewhat similarly, though with FM, it's the frequency of the signal that gets changed, hence the F in FM. FM radios have a special transformer inside them that basically sits idle as long as exactly whatever frequency you're tuned to hits your antenna. But once it detects a small change in that frequency, it outputs a voltage that makes your speakers emit a certain sound. So let's say you're tuned to 99.5 FM on your dial. Since FM works by using very small changes in frequency to carry a signal, you are actually tuned to signals just above and below 99.5 megahertz, which makes that transformer send the voltage to your speakers. Now, although this process makes FM more complicated to engineer than AM, you often get a much clearer, higher quality signal. FM is less susceptible to interference as well, because interference often manifests as amplitude spikes. And AM radio would see these spikes as actual sound to produce, and it would end up coming out of your speakers, while FM cares about variations in frequency rather than amplitude. So an FM radio can just ignore that type of interference, and the death metal you're listening to will come out sounding just as clear and angry as ever. FM also has the advantage of having much higher bandwidth than AM due to the mathematical properties of frequency modulation. This allows for lots of wiggle room in the signal to create more sounds more accurately, making FM the clear choice for music, while AM is often just fine for stuff where high fidelity isn't a big deal, such as talk radio. But if FM is so superior, then why do AM stations seem to have so much better range? Well, it's because AM wavelengths are much longer, meaning that they can move more effectively following even the curvature of the Earth and deal with obstacles like buildings, whereas you can quickly lose high-frequency FM signals if you start putting stuff in the way. AM frequencies also allow signals to cause free electrons in the ionosphere to oscillate at the same frequency as the radio wave that hits them, meaning that AM signals can actually reflect off the upper atmosphere. At night, there are more free electrons hanging out in the sky, which is why you can sometimes hear AM stations from hundreds of miles away after the sun goes down, as opposed to FM, which tends to go right through the atmosphere. Of course, this may not seem impressive when the internet allows you to listen to high-quality digital broadcasts from the other side of the world no problem, but good old analog radio still has the distinct advantage of only requiring a $10 receiver with no subscription fees and very high ease of use, especially for people who might not be terribly tech-savvy. And of course, your radio will keep working even if your finicky internet connection goes out. Sometimes simpler is indeed better.
Recommended videos, phonographs, and radios. Recommended video, what is the electromagnetic spectrum?
Recommended video, a short history of the phonograph.
Recommended video, from phonographs to Spotify, a brief history of the music industry. Ken Burns, America Series 1 Episode 7 Empire of the Air, The Men Who Made Radio. Buy this episode for $5.
Recommended video, history of radio, Hallie D. Forrest. A con artist. Created radio.
Recommended video, a brief history of radio. AM and FM radio as fast as possible.
Recommended video, the 13th of January 1910, world's first public radio broadcast comes from the Met Opera in New York.
Recommended video, entertainment evolution. 2700 BC to 2020 inches.
Recommended video, cinema, radio, and television, Crash Course History of Science number 29. Table of Contents, phonographs and radios. Thanks for watching. Please watch some more of my great videos.